ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. أستغفر الله العظيم. أستغفر الله العظيم. أستغفر الله العظيم.
فلا كتاب بعد كتابه ولا شريعة بعد شريعته. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا توبوا إلى الله توبة نصوحا. صدق الله العظيم. My dear respected elders and brothers, as we are aware, we are fast approaching the last 10 days of the blessed and Mubarak month of Ramadan. Our beloved Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he distributed the month of Ramadan in terms of favor from Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, said awwaluhu rahmah, that the first 10 days of Ramadan bring the rahmat and the mercy of Allah. The second 10 days brings the maghfirat and the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon the believers. And the third 10 days brings emancipation from the fire of Jahannam. Given that the second 10 days is about maghfirat, I thought that we will speak about this aspect today's khutbah. Given Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's favors upon us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would be entitled to ask of us complete devotion. To such an extent that if Allah ta'ala were to have commanded us, do nothing other than ibadat, Allah has created us from nothing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us life. Allah gave us our needs. If Allah were to have done so, it would not have been unjust of Allah to tell us spend 24 hours of your day in it. It would not have been unjust. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has been very merciful. The way Allah ta'ala says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ اشْتَرَى مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ أَنْفُسَهُمْ وَأَمْوَالَهُمْ بِأَنَّ لَهُمُ الْجَنَّةِ. Allah Ta'ala says, I have purchased from you your wealth and your life in lieu of Jannah. I took your life and your wealth, I gave you Jannah. And look at the mercy of Allah. After purchasing it from us, He still allows us flexibility to use our wealth and our physical self to a degree of flexibility in the pursuit of our needs. SubhanAllah. This is the mercy of Allah. It is like a person buying something, and after buying something, he tells the person who sold it, you take it and use it for a little while. You take it and you use it. Don't use it like this, but use it in this particular way. That is the reality how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has shown us His favors. And despite this favors, we are most unfortunate at times that we still disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahmatullah alayh relates a hadith under the chapter Kitab al-Zuhud. Zuhud means abstinence and piety. In this he quotes a hadith of our beloved Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in which Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has narrated the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, meaning it is a hadith a Qudsi. O son of Adam, O Ibn Adam, you are very amazing. I have created you and you worship things other than myself. I created you, you worship someone else besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I provide for you, you make shukr to someone else. I provide for you and you are showing gratefulness to someone else. I show you love by giving you things and yet I do not need you, but I still give you those blessings. While you show me animosity through the means of your sin. I am giving you love, my love is descending upon you, your animosity through sins is coming up towards me. This is such a thought-provoking hadith that gives our situation with regard to our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now when we disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sin and disobedience is no ordinary thing. It is highly detrimental to our spiritual, our physical, our collective existence. There are many, many harms of sin. Among the harms, we find that corruption that comes upon the earth, turmoil, sometimes even natural phenomena, sometimes earthquakes, happen because of the sins of humankind. Allah Ta'ala says in Surah Ar-Rum, in the 21st surah of the Holy Quran, ظهر الفساد في البر والبحر بما كسبت أيدي الناس. Corruption has come upon the earth and upon the ocean because of the doings of mankind. ليذيقهم بعد الذي عملوا. So Allah gives you a taste of that corruption, the taste of the disobedience by bringing a small punishment. لعلهم يرجون, so that you might turn towards Allah Azza wa Jal. Then furthermore, the Quran tells us that many a times individual and collective calamity is because of our sins. 25th part of the Holy Quran, Surah Ash-Shura. وَمَا أَصَابَكُم مِّن مُّصِيبَةٍ فَبِمَا كَسَبَتْ أَيْدِيكُمْ. That whatever calamity becomes upon you, it is because of your guna and your sins. Many a times it is because. Sometimes it is elevation of status, sometimes it is testing, but many a times because of our sins. Then furthermore, Hazrat Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala narrates a hadith which appears in Sahih Bukhari, that إِنَّ الْمُؤْمِنَ يَرَى ذُنُوبَهُ كَأَنَّهُ قَائِدٌ تَحْتَ جَبَلٍ. That a mu'min regards sin as such a great thing that it is as if he is sitting on the bottom of a huge mountain, and he is fearful any time a boulder is going to come from on the top of the mountain and destroy him. That is how a mu'min regards sin. He regards it as burdensome, as if he is under a mountain, worried that any time a boulder or a great rock is going to fall upon him. And وَإِنَّ الْفَاسِقِ وَإِنَّ الْفَاجِرِ. And the transgressor, he looks at sin like a fly sitting on his nose, and he just shakes the fly away. And he does, and he uses his hand, and the fly flies away. And today when we look at our condition with regard to sin, أَلْيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ, we are more in the latter one than the former. We regard sin as easy as like a fly sitting on our nose, and we do something to get the fly to go away. This is the reality with regard. But a mu'min regards sin as burdensome as sitting underneath a mountain, thinking that when is the rock going to fall upon me? Now we cannot allow this to continue, because sin is very destructive. Nabi Karim s.a.w. has also made mention, when a person sins, a black spot appears on his heart. His spiritual heart, not his physical heart. His spiritual heart. And then after that, if he doesn't make tawbah and he sins again, another black spot comes. Until when he continues sinning, the entire heart is engulfed in darkness. It is engulfed in darkness, and then when it is engulfed in darkness, he can't distinguish between right and wrong, between piety and impiety, between vice and virtue, between sin and good. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from such a distressful condition. Now, we cannot allow sin to continue because of its very harmful effects. Our beloved Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and our Sharia has shown us ways of how to wipe away our sins. But before we make mention with regard to how to wipe away our sins, let me give you a physical example. A person wears a clean pair of clothes. Sunnah to wear white on Friday. So he goes and he wears white clothes. And now there are various ways that pair of white clothes can get dirty. Sometimes he crosses an unbaked building. So little bit of the cement, dry cement, comes on his clothes. Now that is very easy for him. He just takes his hands, he wipes it away. That particular little bit of cement or dust goes away. He doesn't need anything else. Sometimes the dirt is more severe than that. So he needs water. He needs water to take away the stain or to take away the dirt. Sometimes, no, it is not good enough only to use water. You have to use soap. Sometimes soap also is not good enough. Sometimes you have to use washing powder. Sometimes that is also not good enough. Hazrat Mufti Mahmood Sahib Rahmatullah Alayhi when he made itikaf here in his masjid, one day gave an example, and he was speaking about this, and he gave this example, and I'm quoting from him. He said that he was one day busy working with tar. And after washing with tar, he used soap, and that tar just could not go away. Someone said tar would not be able to be wiped away with washing powder. Use paraffin. So he used paraffin, the tar came away. Then he used soap to wipe away the effects of the paraffin. Different ways to clean ourselves and to clean our clothes. And sometimes you need a laundry. And sometimes the stain is such, you can't take it out. Now you understand the situation. Now look at how our beloved Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Allah has shown us various ways of how our sins get washed away. One is minor sins. Remember the first example? Just wiping it away, brushing it away. Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, when a mu'min makes wudu and he washes his hands, all the minor sins that he did with his hands get wiped away. And when he washes his face, all the minor sins that he did with his face gets washed away. And whatever minor sins that he committed with a leg gets washed away. So that is something that just a little bit of effort, it gets away because it is minor. Sometimes the sin is such that no, it needs water. Like how he said that that particular thing, it needs more effort. So sometimes you have a penalty. What is the penalty? Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, and Allah Ta'ala tells us in the Holy Quran, you took an oath, you broke the oath. Now you have to give a penalty. The penalty is you have to feed 10 people. من أشرت ما أوست ما تطعمون أهلكم أو كسوتهم, or you go to clothe them. You break your roza without a valid reason, you give a penalty. The penalty is to keep 2 months consecutive fast after Ramadan. So certain sins I wiped away by penalties. Certain sins I wiped away the way we said certain things are wiped away by soap. Certain sins I wiped away by good deeds. A person came to Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and said, Ya Rasulullah, I have committed guna and sin, and purify me. Now the Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam knew the nature of his sin was not that severe. So Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, go and do a good deed. And the good deed will wipe away the evil deed. Go and do a good deed, the good deed will wipe away the evil. إِنَّ الْحَسَنَاتِ يُذْهِبْنَ السَّيِّئَاتِ. The good deed will wipe away the evil deed. But that's a particular type of sin. Certain type of sin, like that stain that doesn't go away, Allah has said, I won't forgive it. May Allah forbid. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ. Allah would not forgive a person who associates partners to Allah. In certain types of sin, we need, the way there is dirt on our clothes, we need to, you know, wash it vigorously. Certain type of sin, we need to make tawbah to Almighty Allah. And then we cry before Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we cry before Almighty Allah, we show regret to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the wrong that we have done. We show a genuine type of sincere type of remorse over what we have done. Then that particular dark spot that engulfs the heart, it slowly moves away. Our heart becomes once again clean, enlightened, to be able to receive Allah's mercy, and to be able once again to receive the rahmat of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these are ways of how to wipe away the effects of our sin. The ulama have also made mention, there are wisdoms why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created good and bad in this world. There are wisdoms. There is no doubt that Allah Ta'ala has created Allahu khaliqu kulli shay. Allah is the creator of everything. Allah Ta'ala says, seek the protection of Allah from evil. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator of evil. Now when we understand that, there are various reasons why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows a person to do sometimes to a degree, Allah has given him that flexibility. Now one of the reasons is that when he exerts himself, despite temptation to stay away from sin, Allah Ta'ala rewards him. So when he does, he has an inclination to do something wrong. Just an example, amongst many other examples, he is on the street, his eyes fall on a strange woman, and with passion he starts looking at there. Now when he makes a conscious effort to turn his gaze away, Allah will reward him. Whereas that reward would not have been forthcoming to him if he did not have the capacity to see the woman, or if he was in a room and there was no woman to see. So the first reason, amongst other things, is through the means of sin, which when we exert ourselves to go against it, Allah rewards us. The second thing is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when we show remorse for the wrong that we have done, Allah elevates our status. Sahih ahadith make mention that with regard to Hazrat Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala, Hazrat Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala used to perform tahajjud prayers every day. One day, through the means of being tired, he could not get up. And because he did not perform tahajjud that day, he felt great remorse. And the whole day he was in remorse. Ya Allah, I didn't perform my tahajjud prayers. Ya Allah, I had this opportunity, I've always been, but I haven't been able to perform. So the next day when he was sleeping, in the privacy of his room, someone at the time of tahajjud came and woke him up. And he was surprised, the room is locked, how is it possible? So he said, who is this who woke me up? You relate to me your identity. At first he was reluctant. Then afterwards he said, I am Iblis. He said, what have you got to do with waking me up, tahajjud? So he said, the reason is, yesterday you showed such remorse for missing out tahajjud that your status was elevated even more than performing tahajjud prayers. Therefore I said, don't let him get such an elevated status. And the third reason is, the ulama say, that Allah Ta'ala has various qualities. And the qualities of Allah Ta'ala must be manifested in various ways. You see, so one of the ways that Allah manifests His quality of forgiveness is to forgive people who show remorse when they do wrong. Subhanallah. Therefore in Sahih Muslim there is a hadith of our beloved Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that our beloved Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لَوْ لَمْ تَذْنِبُوا O believers, if you don't commit sin, then Allah will create another nation who will commit sin, and they will ask Allah with remorse for forgiveness, and Allah will forgive them. This is amazing hadith, but you must not use that as a justification for sin. It means that try your utmost not to do it if it happens, by chance, not deliberately. Now you go and say, no, I'm going to do it deliberately. Aliyadu billah. May Allah ta'ala forbid. I normally give as an example of a person who deliberately goes and sins and says, Allah is forgiving. It is like that person who puts his hand in fire. He puts his hand on the bright fire. And someone says, how can you be sure? But you are going to hurt yourself. You say, no, don't worry. I got my doctor gave me a very good balm to put after I burn. I got very good medicine. After I put it, it will get better. I say, boy, you are foolish. Just that balm is, if in case you get caught in the fire, in case you burn, then you use it. Doesn't now mean because you got that balm, you're going to deliberately put your hand in the fire. That is the example. So this is the way with regard to how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has shown us how to turn as the effects of sin away. Now we must keep in mind that each and everyone, to some degree, is a sinner. Each and everyone. Hazrat Mufti Musab Rahlale one day said, when in his bayan, and he said, if someone tells you, that make tawbah for your sin, and you said, for what was I make tawbah? What did I do wrong? He says that statement is close to kufr. He said that statement is akin and close to kufr. And he gave an example. He said, the best person Allah created was our beloved Nabi Akram Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. The best person in this ummah is Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala. No person in this ummah can match Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala for piety and for his status in front of Allah. But Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala adwa to read after the durood at the time of salat. And what was the dua? Who is teaching? The greatest of Allah's creation. Who is he teaching this dua to? The best of this ummah. And what did he teach him? He said, oh Abu Bakr, after the rood, read this dua. Allahumma inni zalamtu nafsi zulman kathira. Oh Allah, I have done wrong. Wa innahu la yaghfiru dhunuba illa anta. No one can remove wrong except you. Faghfirli and grant me your forgiveness. Maghfiratan min indik, because maghfirat is from you. Now this is the dua that was taught by Nabi Karim sallam to Abu Bakr. What is our condition, my dear respected brothers? And he gives an example in the Quran. Allah Ta'ala told Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, if qala lahu rabbuhu aslim. Allah Ta'ala told Ibrahim, become and submit to the commands of Allah and become a Muslim. So Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam, what doubt can we have that he was a Muslim? He was the best of Muslims, the best who submitted. He even went to sacrifice his son for the sake of Allah. But when Allah told him aslim, he didn't say I'm a Muslim. He didn't say why must I make tawbah? He didn't say I'm not a Muslim. He immediately said, Aslamtu li Rabbil Alameen. I submit to the Lord of the world. Therefore, a person must never say that, why must I make Tawbah? If anyone refers him to Tawbah, immediately will say, Ya Allah, forgive me for my sin that I have committed. I would like to leave you today with a dua that I, someone sent me by email of Hazrat Uwais Qarni radiallahu ta'ala anhu, the best of the tabi'in after the Sahaba. And he made this dua to Almighty Allah. Allahumma khalaqtani wa lam aku shay'an mazkura. Oh Allah, you created me when I was nothing. I was not in existence. Wa razaqtani wa lam amliku shay'an. You sustained me and I had nothing. I had nothing, but you sustained me. وَظَلَمْتُ نَفْسِي And I have done wrong unto my soul. وَارْتَكَبْتُ الْمَعَاسِي And I have committed disobedience to you, Allah. وَأَنَا مُقِرٌّ بِذَنْبِي And oh Allah, I admit and profess to the wrong that I have done. إِنْ غَفَرْتَ لِي فَلَا يَنْقُصُ مِنْ مُلْكِكَ If you were to forgive me, it won't make no dent to your authority and your kingdom. وَإِن تُعَذِّبْنِي And if you were to punish me, it won't add to your stature. If you were to punish me, it won't add to your stature. And it won't add to your authority. And وَإِنَّكَ تَجِدُ You can, if you will, find someone to punish besides me. But I can't find anyone besides you. Forgive me. What an amazing dua that we can ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when we ask for forgiveness for our sins. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.